And congratulations to Pat and Ivor, very well deserved. I'm going to talk today largely about the project that I've spent the last few years doing, which is on how teachers understand and promote fundamental British values in schools. I was also going to talk a little bit about the process of doing the research, but I think I might run into the coffee break if I do that, and I definitely don't want to do that. But I can answer any questions about the actual process of being in schools doing research. Which is not actually, oddly enough, although I've been doing this, my ninth funded research project, actually most of my work hasn't been in schools, it's been with parents. So this one has been quite a new experience for me. Okay, since, just to make sure everybody knows what I'm talking about, since 2014, teachers in schools in England have been required to promote the fundamental British values defined by the government as democracy, the rule of law, individual liberty, mutual respect and tolerance of those of different faiths. The English Schools Inspector Ofsted included the promotion of British values and how a school prepares pupils for life in modern Britain as part of its inspections. I'm interested in what the formulation of this policy and its enactment by teachers can tell us about who belongs and who does not in the Liberal policy. This talk is not going to be a full discussion of the findings of my project. If anybody is interested, there's an article just coming out in British Journal of Sociology of Education that's about the interim findings, and I'll be holding a dissemination event at UCL in November. So everybody will be very welcome to that. But today I'm going to discuss the process of researching and analysing policy enactment. In particular, taking a policy sociology approach, I'm going to start with the premise that policy enactment cannot be understood without reference to the wider political and social context. I'm going to discuss this wider context, focusing on the tilt towards xenophobia, which we see reflected in education in the formation of a policy ensemble of securitisation. Major elements of this being the prevent duty and the requirement to promote fundamental British values. I then go on to draw attention to the effective dimension of the policy context, and illustrate how this effective dimension, which I suggest derives from a broader social and political context of anxiety about and suspicion of and hostility towards the stranger, how that plays out in enactment of the policy, that is, in school responses to promoting fundamental British values, or FBVs. The American political philosopher Bonnie Honey argued that solving the problem of foreigners underlies contemporary discussions of democracy and citizenship, and the attitudes towards the foreigner are shot through with ambivalence. The foreigner is both potential threat and potential saviour. Honig illustrates her case with examples from American literature, but I'm going to use here an example from Shakespeare, which is very relevant, as studying Shakespeare was occasionally suggested to me as a way of promoting British values. So, in Hamlet, in Fortinbras, Prince of Norway appears in the final moments on the stage filled with the dead body of the play's protagonist to stabilise the collapsing state of Denmark by taking the crown. Most immigrants cannot become ruler of their new nation, but Honig argues that the good immigrant, in inverted commas, on a trajectory to citizenship will make the kind of explicit connection and commitment to the state, for example, citizenship ceremonies, that the native-born population do not, therefore legitimising and energising the consent basis of the state. However, the shadow of the bad immigrant, the illegal alien, remains potent. Since Honig was writing, the settlement between xenophobia and xenophilia has shifted towards xenophobia in both the UK and the USA. The illegality of the alien and his or her illegitimate consumption of the nation-state's resources is sketched in lurid tabloid colours as migration from both Eastern Europe and poor and war-torn parts of Africa and the Middle East continue. Particularly since 9/11, an additional shadow posed by the alien has come to the fore, a sense of threat to our way of life and migrant populations, or populations with migrant heritage, positioned as not sharing our values and not wishing to integrate. alongside this, a narrative also persists of a Britain as a country with a long multi-ethnic history, a country, moreover, that is at ease with diversity. In recent years, the London 2012 Olympics, the marriage of biracial Meghan Markle into the royal family, and the multiracial 20 England football team have all been presented as evidence of a country open to and comfortable with ethnic difference. Wouldn't necessarily say that narratives have the same weight, but it does exist. So I'm going to go on to discuss in more detail the tilt towards xenophobia. But before I do that, for anyone not familiar with the area, I just want to point out three basic tenets of the policy sociology approach. I did have a list of policy sociologists to include, but it was very long, so I probably should leave it out. In order to understand any policy, it is at first necessary to consider the context in which the policy is enacted. And second, there is no simple straight line between what a policy text states and what happens on the ground. Hence the term used by Stephen Ball, Meg Maguire, and Annette Board, enactment, rather than policy implementation. Enactment describes the process by which those who operate at ground level, Lipskin's street-level bureaucrats, includes teachers, interpret and reinterpret the policy context to fit the needs of their pupils or clients, and also their understanding of what can mentally, physically, and emotionally be achieved. However, and this is my third point, this does not mean the space for interpretation and the translation is endless. Ball and his colleagues remind us that policies act as discursive strategies. Read the rest of that quote, but the way that policies produce particular subjectivities. We are witnessing a situation in which the context of alarm over migration and terror attacks in Western Europe are driving discourses around the foreigner into becoming both increasingly defensive and aggressive. In Britain, we've seen a formal retreat from what ex-Prime Minister Cameron calls state multiculturalism. Multiculturalism, in recognising and celebrating difference, challenges liberal universalism. However, it came to be presented as fostering isolation and segregation, encouraging minority groups to live in separation from the mainstream, that is the white mainstream. Cameron also famously declared the need for a muscular liberalism, which would assert the particular values of a nation. The policy emphasis has moved towards cohesion in a range of European states. Governments increasingly turn towards what has been called civic integration policies, meaning the obligatory integration of minorities into participation in mainstream institutions through citizenship instruction and tests. This can be understood as part of a broader move towards neoconservative policies that glorify a particular vision of the past associated with the dominant group and its understanding of traditional values. Multiculturalism is presented leading to a situation where minority groups impose their unreasonable demands over the concerns of the majority and abuse the tolerance of that majority. Their difference apparently threatens the integrity, safety, and security of Britain and other Western European nations. Some commentators have argued over the degree of retreat from multiculturalism, suggesting that multicultural policies persist in many European countries, and that they are in fact layered with civic integration policies. But I think it's probably more fair to say that that multicultural policies are becoming not layered, but in fact buried by civic integration policies. Additionally, and fundamentally, for years commentators have argued that multiculturalism itself does not issues of ingrained and entrenched white privilege. However, the discursive retreat from multiculturalism, for all its faults, is surely significant, as it reflects and perpetuates the demonising of immigrants and those of immigrant heritage. Lenzen has argued that critiques of multicultural policy are not, in fact, a critique of a policy en song, but rather the actual presence, a critique of the actual presence of those with different racial, ethnic, cultural heritage, those who are not us, with an anxiety about the result of a lived multiculture. Lenzen continues, the culture has become the sphere in which differences mark. Thus the furore of multiculturalism is not separate from the story of racism, rather it is its contemporary manifestation. The idea that racial and cultural minorities have or might easily gain the upper hand leads to calls for countering their excess with more of our culture, more citizenship events, nationalist commemorations, and integration tests. Thus, the space for the reassertion of national values is opened up. And I'll just very briefly talk about the policy ensemble of securitisation. Many of this will be familiar to you. Schools have been drawn into the securitisation matrix, and I'm hardly the first to point this out, but most of the critique is focused on prevent the anti-extremist policy. And the prevent duty, a legal responsibility on staff and public bodies to have due regard to the need to prevent people from being drawn into terrorism. This means that teachers have a duty to identify and report any colleagues or pupils displaying signs of being at risk of being drawn into terrorism or any support for extremist values defined as opposition to fundamental British values. Prevent is widely understood as a strategy to address the so-called hidden threat potential terrorists born and raised in Britain. It is, despite later versions evoking far-right radicalisation in addition to Islamist extremism, still widely criticised, targeting and alienating Muslim minorities, thus further condemning Muslims for their difference and presumed conservatism. Government figures to March 2017 showed that the majority of referrals to Prevent, 61% of the total, continue to relate to Islamist extremism. Many teachers in my research and other research that's been done on this understand their responsibilities under the Prevent duty as part of safeguarding vulnerable minors, but the surveillance element is clear. The requirement to promote fundamental British values represents a softer heart and mind policy in order to build loyalty and commitment to the nation state. However, it is important to point out, in line with what I said earlier about enactment, that Prevent, as O'Toole argues, cannot be straightforwardly understood as a form of discipline, given that on the ground its practices have been what she calls contradictory, incoherent, and contested. The appointment to Prevent education officers in some local authorities has also created a further group of street-level bureaucrats, mediating in the uneasy space between central government agendas and the what they understand to be the priorities on the ground. The requirement to promote fundamental British values can be seen as an example of civic nationalism. Civic or liberal nationalism basically says, whoever you are, if you can sign up to this set of democratic, if you can sign up to this set of political and social principles, then you can belong, regardless of your race, religion, ethnicity. This is an attempt to emphasize commitment to the nation that doesn't rely on being born in the country and belonging to the dominant ethnic group. The focus is on shared political ideals rather than the commonality of land and soil. A recent example of this came from Ofsted Chief Inspector when she said, these are values, British values, that give a simple message to our young people. No matter what your background, in Britain you can fit in, you can succeed, and you can belong. Other factors, however, seem to be sending quite contradictory messages. The tightening of citizenship regulations, for example. The Home Office's policy of creating a hostile environment. Home Office figures for 2016-17 showing a rise in recorded hate crimes. The introduction of mandatory and expensive citizenship tests. And I could go on. These are measures designed to reassure what Eisen calls the neurotic citizen, that the boundaries around the nation, in Brown's words, are sufficiently high and arduous. Those who are already a member of the nation are allowed to fit in, providing their values meet with ours. And anxiety and suspicion have coalesced around Muslims, often spoken about as if they were a homogenous group. Cameron's muscular liberalism speech that I referred to earlier collapsed the distinction between political extremism and a religious group. More recently, we've seen the normalisation of suspicion, hostility and ridicule when prominent mainstream politician and ex-Foreign Secretary Boris Johnson likened women who wear the niqab to letterboxes, bank robbers and rebellious teenagers. The immediate spur to the introduction of the requirement to promote British values in schools was the Trojan Horse affair, the alleged infiltration by extremist Muslims of state schools in Birmingham. The affair is complex, and there's a detailed review by Homewood and O'Toole if you want to read more about it. Now, the 2015 Houghton report by the House of Commons Education Select Committee concluded that apart from one instance, there was no evidence of extremism or radicalisation found by any of the Trojan Horse inquiries. However, despite this, the Trojan Horse affair remains a shorthand for undue and subversive Muslim influence. Thus, the link between anti-radicalisation, anti-extremism, and the requirement that schools promote British values was clear from the beginning. Mary Healy argues that citizenship should be understood as requiring belonging across three dimensions: formal membership, a sense of belonging, and the perceptions by others that one belongs. Given the context outlined above, many minority groups, and especially young British-born Muslims, may feel that their belonging is not accepted by the majority group. To assert an integrationist perspective of shared values, as the British Values Policy does, across the uneven terrain of belonging, is likely to work not to integrate, but rather to emphasise the inequalities in religious recognition and respect. So thus we have a current political climate where ethnic and religious diversity, but noticeably not socioeconomic diversity and inequalities, are seen as a threat to social cohesion. So that's the context for my research. I'm just going to briefly tell you about what I did. This has been a qualitative piece of research based on interviews and observations, 9 case study schools, some one-off interviews with a further set of senior leaders, and interviews with 12 other professionals, what have been called mid-level policy enactors who decode policy for teachers. Just to come back to the policy enactment idea, Stephen Porter makes the often cited distinction between policy as text and policy as discourse. The former, policy as text, emphasises the micro-politics of the context, both amongst those who write the text and those who translate it. This includes the history, relationship and values of both of those groups, the wider circles of influence upon them. Schools may respond to policy initiatives in very different ways, depending on their Ofsted rating, the perceived needs of their local population, the role of particular teachers. The role of ad hocery, making do improvisation, can't be overlooked. There are also layers of policy sediment that past policies leave. An example here is that I was particularly interested in how schools manage community cohesion alongside their new obligation to promote fundamental British values. Promoting community cohesion was removed from the Ofsted inspections after 2011, and the phrase itself seems to become obsolete in schools. However, my data does show that some traces of community cohesion, and indeed older multicultural policies, still exist in an amorphous set of commitments, vaguely expressed as providing a harmonious school community where the pupils feel they belong and are treated equally, and this is still a powerful motivator of practice. A layer of policy sediment. The British Values Policy text itself is a loose, enabling one, 9 pages long. This means that teachers are able to respond with creativity, assuming, of course, that they have the time and inclination to do this. And some of the responses in schools are clearly clearly a rational exercise in making the mandated responses quickly and easily as possible, given the tsunami of activity in schools. So in this example, for instance, this head teacher laminated the keywords and put them up in the corridor, tick the box. The capacity for teacher interpretation and translation is not endless, and this is where the pause for Cody and understanding of policy's discourse comes in. He says there are real policy struggles over the interpretation of enactment of policy, but these are set within a moving discursive frame which articulates and constrains possibilities for interpretation and enactment. And the discursive frame relevant here, as I argued earlier, is one of anxiety and suspicion around strangers, people who might not behave like us, do what we do, or believe in what we believe. The immigrant, the assumed to be conservative Muslim, those who are understood as resistant to integration, are positioned as a block to cohesion. For cohesion is the desired state where people come together and differences are forgotten, often claimed to appear momentarily and tantalisingly at royal celebrations and sporting tournaments. However, alongside this and entangled in complex ways are different impulses. An impulse to welcome difference, to see ourselves as tolerant, convivial, and cosmopolitan. I suggest in order to understand this, in addition to policy as text and policy as discourse, we need to focus attention on the effective elements of the policy enactment process. I'm drawing on Ben Anderson's definition of affect as an umbrella category, describing distinct ways of organising the feeling of resistance. He argues that we need to pay attention to the effective properties of a particular time period in a particular place. He takes Raymond Williams' well-known term, the structure of feeling, and the more current term, atmospheres, as two ways of understanding affect in relation to contemporary political and social formations. Anderson cites Williams' definition of a structure of feeling as the felt sense of the quality of life in a defined period. Williams defines structures of feeling as a way of analysing social changes that insist on effective everyday life experience, but also maintain a focus on mediating structures. Thus, the term refers to the effective, orderly, emotional experience of living in a particular period of time. Anderson notes the structures of feeling in general disperse moods and extend beyond particular sites. His second understanding of affect is atmospheres. Atmospheres are ephemeral, effective impressions that envelop particular enclosed forms, such as a meeting, or I would suggest a classroom. Anderson talks also of policy tone, resulting from a cluster of more or less vague, effective impressions that accompany a policy. So I want to consider this in relation to school responses to FBV and explore the tone of the policy ensemble of securitisation, the atmosphere of the policy ensemble, and particularly the requirements to promote FBV, both responds to and promotes. In response to the perceived threat of the outsider who refuses to integrate, there is the observant watchfulness of the prevent duty and the hearts and minds orientation of fundamental British values, exhorting commitment to the nation. As I said earlier, civic nationalism offers belonging based not on ethnicity, race or religion, but on one's adherence to a set of political principles, such as those laid out in the values. However, commentators have argued that it is difficult to offer citizens pure attachment to political principles without there being an ethnic element. And in examining my data, I became aware of the extent to which a narrow cultural and ethnic definition of Britishness was illustrated by the data. Teachers sometimes deployed this narrow definition, sometimes resisted it, but it had a clear persistence. I'm going to offer three examples. In doing so, I draw an animal analysis that I've done in my research data, where I identify four main responses to the fundamental British values policy. And here I'm going to mention the two most common, representing Britain and repackaging FBV. The representing Britain response involves the use of British symbols and stereotypes rather than values and principles. You may have come across this poster, it's pretty ubiquitous. You can see that it's got symbols associated with Britain. It's got British seasons, British artists, British music, British food, British festivals, all traditionally white British festivals. There is a brief reference to multicultural days. And then the rest is kind of early years sort of socialisation. Despite criticism from Ofsted, this is an approach that still persists. It's a satisfying response that lends itself to a certain amount of stereotyping around Britain and British symbols and customs, which are made to stand in for values. The difficulty with this approach, and here you'll be here, you'll be there before me, is that particular objects, behaviours, people, oppositions as British, suggesting that others might not be British, quietly exclusionary logic. How do young children receive such information? Are they not British if they don't eat British food? What British food is defined by post-Oxford? What is the effective atmosphere of a classroom that has this poster on the wall? Even in my case study scores, and they didn't primarily adopt this approach to British values, but there were instances. A teacher at one secondary school suggested that visiting Shakespeare's Globe Theatre in London and the opportunity for the pupils to have a reward tea with the head teacher, drinking tea from China cups, both counted as a promotion of British values. And a primary head teacher suggested taking the children to a pantomime as an example. Although there is research that indicates teacher discomfort with patriotism in schools, the abundance of Union Jacks, and you can now get to make your own Union Jack bunting, suggests that many teachers feel comfortable with a patriotism life, featuring the Queen and the achievements and famous of the white male British people. Moncrief and Moncrief's study, presented at last year's bureau, focused on the visual imagery of primary school display boards, making this argument. They described one display board's images of the Queen, a red London bus, a cup of tea, Winston Churchill, William Shakespeare, John Lewis, and a bulldog. Symbols and stereotypes rather than values. Yet to many, but crucially not to all, these are images with a non-rational emotional power that suggests security, unity, and attachment. One might ask if this avalanche of Union Jacks was a preliminary response in some sort, given the lack of guidance from the DfE. The British values displays continue, however, and as recently as May this year, one primary school in the North West claimed its reenactment of the wedding of the Duke and Duchess of Suffolk as tying in with our work on British values. Again, confusing a popular British icon of the royal family with political and social values. These are examples of banal everyday nationalism. Banal nationalism, Michael Billig's term, draws attention to the way in which, in established states, the idea of the nation is reproduced through everyday and mundane indicators. Replications of flag, national sports teams learning about national heroes, and with regard to this country, the detailed coverage of the royal family. These are all unremarked and taken for granted instances of nation flagging. And everyday national, they permeate daily life. Everyday nationalism signals the same quotidian process of the nation sustaining, but as well as focusing on the state's dissemination of messages, is an idea that explores how people, such as teachers, respond to and take up and feel about national identity. So I'm arguing that this particular approach to enacting FBV, which focuses on symbols and stereotypes, it is an illustration of the extent to which emphasis on heritage and traditional cultural symbols and practices is generally understood as unremarkable, so embedded into the fabric of school repertoires that it often passes unnoticed. These symbols strongly indicate a monocultural, monolingual Britain with a culture that is fixed and static, to be learnt about by children, but not contributed to or changed by them. Imagine being a young child sitting underneath that poster I have and not being able to find any representation of your family's lifestyle. Okay, my second example of the implications of the policy stone and the atmosphere it broke is to draw attention to the way in which suspicion of Muslim others appears to be legitimised in public debate. The head teacher at one of my case study primary schools had introduced a strong and progressive strand of equalities work, covering homophobia, sexism, racism, disabilism. However, this was at least partially informed by a belief that the majority of Muslim families at the school were particularly in need of such work. Alone amongst the teacher respondents, and I must stress that this was the only one who voiced the level of hostility, the school leader expressed his concern with hostility. I'll lead you to read that. Some common tropes about Muslims are presented there, as you will see, and they are either, for example, hypocritical about their religion or too religious. And religiosity is associated with bodily displays, such as clothing, fully veiled women wearing the niqab, presented as passive and isolated. Those women who wear a hijab, pursuing a perspective, a hidden agenda. They join the governing body in the Parent Teacher Association, but for the wrong reasons, apparently, not to help the school, but to voice a conservative religious agenda on it. And you'll see the reference to the Trojan horse there. This head teacher had faced significant clashes in values between the school and some of the children's parents. And I must emphasize that such clashes are likely to be experienced taught by school staff as personal, painful, exhausting. It's an attitude, however, that I'm interested in, one of alertness to, almost an expectation of incursions. As our discussion progressed, it was clear that his muscular liberalism positioned himself, the staff, the school's curriculum, shielding the children against their parents, community, and religion. I didn't bring it along, but I do have a quote in which he says that. This is, I argue, symptomatic of, and indeed enabled by, the structure of feeling of a political and social climate hyper-vigilant to the possibility of illiberal actions from Muslim populations. The head appears to exemplify Taylor's liberalism as a fighting breed. He was a leader who offered strong support for liberal democratic values, but few signs of accommodation with the assumed culture of the people's family, understanding that it's isolated from the mainstream, the white mainstream. He doesn't hold a pluralistic conception of citizenship, a key aspect of which Rajani describes as regarding the stranger as having equal dignity and moral worth. His mission instead was, in the words of Anne-Marie Fortier, the need to instill Britishness into the heart of all minorities, suggesting that however ordinary their lives might appear, minorities are always suspect of being not ours at heart. Other staff in other schools in the research that had significant Muslim populations described their Muslim young people as being very aware of this suspicion. So again, ECD school prevents every student in the school. That's what it means to talking about them. Our young people that was in a Muslim majority school absolutely feel the media don't like them. The community is really very much under attack. The second to last one is something that lots of teachers said, that when terrorism attacks were discussed in school, the Muslim pupils were uncertain and unhappy about how to respond. For Muslim members of staff, their families say, just be really careful. You don't want to be somebody who causes a problem. That's from a faith school. So, my third and last example of the permeation of this narrow definition of Britishness is in some ways a counterexample, and in some ways not. At the beginning of this talk, I used Hornick to discuss ambivalence towards the foreigner, which includes a sometimes and some places desire to appreciate difference and diversity. And indeed, the teachers in most of the case study schools work to show appreciation of their multi-ethnic populations and present diversity as a strength. They try to tone down potentially sharp nationalistic edges of the British values policy, understanding the labelling of the values as British as having the potential to alienate their minoritised populations. They worked, as Ms. Zee and Zan argue, to ensure the maintenance of more inclusionary discourses consistent with their existing aims. I've called this response repackaging. By this I mean the schools neutralise the exclusionary potential of FDV by absorbing the policy into their everyday practice. So, having a school council as an example of promoting democracy, having school rules illustrates the rule of law, pupils choosing to make good or bad choices, individual liberty. Some of this may seem to veer dangerously close to tokenism, but I also want to draw attention to teachers' more proactive responses, their commitment to promoting mutual respect and engaging in work to promote equality between minorities and the majorities, consistent with their public sector equality duties under the Equality Act. And I'll just very quickly give you an example. These and other curriculum passages and initiatives to work with the pupils was some of the main examples in the schools that I visited. So those are No Outsiders is primary school package, for example. The UNICEF Rights Spectrum, which you're probably familiar with. Stonewall, Show Racism in the Red Card. Specialist work on the Holocaust, which is something that is promoted out of UCL. Pride groups, Model UN, children acting as the UN, a philosophy for children, painting and prison. Staff were also sensitive to the students possibly not seeing the Union Jack as a symbol of inclusion, and many were critical of the representing Britain approach. These are both teachers for multi-ethnic schools. So at Kensan, I think the fact we have so many people from other countries, I don't think anyone would question the values themselves. But the flag bit just sort of stuck out for us. And the primary head teacher felt the abundance of unity that was reductionist and crass. What was much less common, however, was critical engagement with the values themselves. And this is where my counter-example gets a bit less counter. This process of repackaging, absorbing the British values requirement into already existing practice was a very rational business-as-usual response. It also meant the schools in my research had not increased the space of their curriculum for explicit engagement with these political and social values. Their relationship to a xenophobic, nor did they discuss their relationship, the relationship with the values, to a xenophobic structure of feeling, leaving the children to make sense themselves of the gap between the values that their state says they promote and what they could see around them in society. Indeed, there was limited time for debate and discussion of any sort in a system dominated by student performance in written exams. So, just to wrap that up, what I've tried to do in this talk is to consider the messy processes of policy enactment in relation to one part of a policy ensemble of securitisation, the enactment of a loosely defined requirement to promote fundamental British values. I've argued that the promotion of fundamental British values as developing children and young people's commitment to liberal democratic values and to the nation state appears as a promise that anyone who belongs can belong, anyone who signs up to this list of political and social principles. Yet by paying attention to the affective dimension, the nature of the public debate, and the emotion of the messages disseminated about who belongs and who doesn't, about the characteristics and the habits of the proper citizen body, how they dress, eat, what music British citizens should apparently listen to. All of this signals to pupils how citizens are encouraged to feel about others than themselves. By paying attention to this, we can see that the context and enactment of the policy belies the liberal civic nationalist promise of inclusion. In terms of the wider political and social context, what Raymond Williams calls the structure of feeling, the affective, bodily, emotional experience of living in a particular period of time, the balance between what Bauman called mixophilia and mixophobia appears to have swung towards mixophobia. Although a thin strand of mixophilia, of welcoming diversity, of commitment to equal citizen belonging, still persists unevenly distributed across people and places. Considering the enactment of the British values policy, I focused here on one approach, one response, representing Britain, the transmission of blunt stereotypes, the depiction of a monolingual, monocultural nation through this response. Other teachers have rejected that, have emphasized diversity and equality. But these teachers are having to squash such work into the marginal fringes of the curriculum, often in personal social health education and RE, and if schools still teach it as a separate subject, which many don't, citizenship education. These are all marginal subjects, they're not part of the EBAN. Focus programs of critical citizenship education seem to be getting less and less common in schools, given a crowded curriculum and a performative education system. There's not very rational responses from teachers. If there was a serious government commitment to developing people's understanding of and support for the FBV, that would surely require exploration and debate around their meaning and practice in our societies, which would, I argue, require a programme of critical citizenship education. Without this, I argue the fundamental British values are likely to remain at best merely words and pictures on a school display board, and at worst, words and pictures that actively work to exclude. Thank you.
so much. It brought back for me my early years as a teacher, starting in inner city London, not far from King's Cross, and then going on to Bradford afterwards. Very different experiences, and racism, class were my issues then. It's kind of troubling to see some of the stuff. I don't know if you noticed in that dreadful slide with the Queen and the Union Jack, in the pop groups was a group called Diversity. Now we're going to take some questions in a moment, and then once we've had the time for some questions, I've got one final very joyful task to carry out and another amazing vote of thanks. But let's open this out for people who've got questions, and I guess somebody, maybe me, will perhaps take a microphone to you.
Thank you, Carol. I've spent a lot of time over the last year inspecting schools in London, interestingly enough. My question relates to that kind of, did you actually meet any school leaders who had an absolutely sound understanding of why we were doing British values and why British values, what that would mean to the children within their school?
I suppose that would depend on how you define a sound understanding. I met a fair amount of cynicism amongst teachers. And some of it was because this was another new thing. And this was, I meant to say this and I didn't. We also have to remember the specific context in which policies arriving in schools when there have been major changes in curriculum assessment for primary and secondary schools and are just working out. So this was another thing that was coming in on top of that. So there was a lot of cynicism. There was a particular dislike of the term British. Attached to what our set of liberal democratic values. There was a feeling that the teaching profession hadn't been consulted. There were a few people who said, yes, this gives us some opportunities to do some work around equality. But I think that was constrained by the need to get good results in a range of EBAP subjects. So I think very much schools were saying to me, if it was important to them, we were doing this anyway. Very few people, worse than very few people saw it as an opportunity.
Hi, Carol. So just to follow up on that, what's your take on Ofsted's role in relation to all of this? Because I think that's quite an important context, Jordan.
Yeah. I think it's very difficult to say. What I found was that Ofsted reports often have half a sentence on British values, so the school is promoting British values well. Certainly when the policy was first introduced, schools were downgraded because they weren't promoting British values, they weren't preparing pupils for life in London, and that includes schools with a majority of white British population, because they weren't introducing their pupils to diversity that exists in other parts of Britain. So it's quite difficult to be clear about this. I know Ofsted has said several times publicly, Amanda Spearman said, we don't want schools crafting pictures of the Queen out of sequins. We don't want schools children doing that. And that's not the sort of representative British approach, is not what they're looking for. But generally, there has perhaps been a lack of guidance. Certainly I spoke to one Muslim faith, the head teacher of a Muslim faith school, state-funded school, who felt that she was particularly under an Ofsted glare, if you like, in terms of British values. So several people did suggest to me that it was useful for Ofsted to have, if they felt there was possible illiberalism in schools, that then they could bring in British values policy. So I think it's a mixed response from Ofsted.
Hi, thank you very much for that. I just wanted to ask, from your sample of schools, whether any of the schools had very few or little in terms of ethnic minority children or teachers, and if there was any difference.
I missed a little bit of that. Any of the schools were?
Any of the schools in the sample that you had that didn't have many children from ethnic minorities or teachers, and if there was a difference.
I had three schools that were majority, as in over 90% white British. It's quite difficult to say straightforwardly. I think the word differences that I found, that they were minor differences. And one interesting thing that I haven't talked about today, that I will be talking about more, is that the teachers in two of the schools particularly that had working class white British populations felt very much that one of their roles was to liberalise the pupils and their families, and that those pupils were particularly like to be racist or xenophobic, and that the work that they could do was around that. But again, it was something that they'd been doing anyway. But it was interesting that nobody in the schools with significant white British middle class populations said that kind of thing. Middle classes were generally assumed to be liberal, and the working classes generally assumed to be unliberal. There were differences, yeah.
Thanks, Carol, for your talk. My name is Pete Boyd. I'm at University of Cumbria. And thank you very much. It's very interesting. People are being a little bit cautious, so I'll try and push on it a little bit. But at the risk of everybody just forgiving me if I'm clumsy in my question. I'm interested in solutions, and I'm also interested to be so critical of a government policy, you know, to be quite critical of it, damning of the way it's enacted. I agree with you, it's maybe enacted is the problem. But in a way, I look at the solutions. I think we tried citizenship. I know you have got critical citizenship there. So my question is around teacher education and continuing development. Given that that has generally become a kind of technical training, I'm generalising. So in a way, before we could enhance the curriculum, maybe there's a huge challenge there. But I also like to push on the fact that multiculturalism, when I've been in teacher training for a long time, you know, we did emphasise multiculturalism. And in a way, I think a lot of disrespect in Britain at the moment is around social disadvantage. There's a lack of respect. It's not related. It's mixed up with race and gender and so on, but it's really about poverty and increasing inequality. And yet your talk and the critique of of FBV doesn't enter into that very much. So there's two issues.
I did say very briefly that one of the things that wasn't discussed in the class, this is what I found in schools actually, in the course of the work that they were doing, one of the things that doesn't feature is social class and inequalities and income. So, but to get back to the programme, I did have a couple of slides. There was some instances of work that I saw in schools, and I've talked about this in more other events, and I'll be writing about this, that I thought was excellent in terms of citizenship education. Citizenship education itself has been pushed to the fringes, the margins, and that hiatus when Michael Gove was deciding whether he was going to abolish it or not seems to have led to a hiatus in many schools. Again, understandably, why put your resources on something that you think might be about to abolish? And the number of providers and training specialist citizenship education teachers has dropped. The number of specialist trained citizenship education teachers has dropped. So capacity in schools is obviously a real issue. And I do have a whole section of analysis where I'm looking at what teachers say about carrying on difficult conversations with students. And there's certainly a lack of, quite understandably, I mean, the lessons, I sat in several lessons where teachers were discussing terrorism with children. It's incredibly difficult to do. And people are not trained for this. And it's seen as marginal in terms of importance. So absolutely all that. My criticism is aimed at the way in which the policy has been put out by government and the way in which it's been enacted by some schools. But even the Representing Britain approach, which I think is dark, you can see the rationality behind it. And I was trying to explain what I understood to be the wider context for shaping that response. But I find that focus on a narrow definition of Britain as belonging to the white British a concerning me. And it seems to work against so many things that so many people in this room have been writing about and arguing about for so long.
I think we'll have this final question.
Just to go on the
go any further into that, we're a small Australian delegation up here, and given our sort of shambolic political environment, we get very nervous about replication of British policies in this sense. But to what extent is the intent of the policy well worked? And you've been illustrating how it hasn't been well worked. So you wonder to what extent it still just sits at the political level, and indeed there's been administrative resistance or acquiescence or whatever to not take it into deep policy. And so the notion of people and their interpretation is one thing, but is the policy intent deep, or is it the political focus is the strongest?
Yeah, I think the political focus is the strongest. I mean, I was at a conference last year where there was people from the DfE and the Home Office talking, and certainly they are committed to both prevent and fundamental British values. But I can't see how it's expected to work, because there isn't the space for the children to engage with the values. So if you want commitment to a particular set of values, then surely you have to invest time. You can't just put the words up in the wall. Surely you have to invest time in discussing it with the children and young people. And that's not what seems to be happening. And certainly the people who do training on social moral, spiritual moral, social and cultural education, of which British values are seen to be part, recommend that as an approach, engaging with the values, but I saw very little of it. And I asked teachers to direct me towards places where they thought British values were being promoted, and I ended up in a huge different variety of places. So I saw primary school children making videos on good manners. I went to a coffee morning between senior citizens in year 9. I went to work around the Holocaust. I mean, a huge range of things. It's so not defined by the DfE that schools are kind of throwing things at it in a kind of rat bag sort of manner.
Thank you ever so much. Can we give a round of applause?